would concur. It's a blessing to see the young generation step up. One thing I've noticed as I've grown older and as the generations pass, that concerning the younger generation, as it pertains to serving the Lord, the bench is getting thin. You know, the world has a lot to offer, and if we're not careful, we make that our focus, you know. And it's easy in America to make those things our focus. And so I appreciate that. That's a rough-looking front row over there, but I appreciate it being there, all right? And there's hope for you guys. I want you to know that. And appreciate it. Well, let's take our Bibles tonight. And let's go to the book of James. We've been in the book of James. Appreciate you being here tonight. And let's go to the book of James. And once you've found your place in James chapter 2, I would invite you to stand. I'm delighted to see how the Lord blessed in the surgery today for Miss Brianna. And we're happy for that. Brother Craig, good to see you. And prayed for you. Prayed for that whole situation. Got an overnight on top of it, right? We prayed for that very specifically. All right. Well, James chapter 2, you follow along as I begin reading in verse number 1. The Bible says in James 2 and verse 1, "My brethren, have not the faith of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord of glory, with respect of persons. For if there come unto your assembly a man with a gold ring and goodly apparel, and there come in also a poor man in vile raiment, and ye have respect to him that weareth the gay clothing, and say unto him, Sit thou here in a good place, and say to the poor, Stand thou there, or sit here under my footstool. Are ye not then partial in yourselves, and are become judges of evil thoughts? Hearken, my beloved brethren, hath not God chosen the poor of this world, notice this, rich in faith, and heirs of the kingdom which he hath promised to them that love him? But ye have despised the poor. Do not rich men oppress you and draw you before the judgment seats? Do not they blaspheme that worthy name by the which you're called? If ye fulfill the royal law according to the scripture, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself, ye do well. But if ye have respect to persons, ye commit sin and are convinced of the law as transgressors." Here in the book of James, we're continuing the series of thoughts I began last night, focusing on what James really is focusing on, which is authentic Christianity. Authentic Christianity. And the message that just leaps off the pages of the book of James is, it's a call, it's a clarion call, it's almost a command. The entire book of James seems to say, grow up. Grow up in your faith and in the knowledge of your Savior. I'd like to preach another thought on growing up and what authentic Christianity is according to the Bible, specifically the book of James. Let's pray. Our Father, we thank you tonight for the messages we've heard these past couple of days. And Lord, the music that's lifted our hearts and the fellowship we've enjoyed, thank you for meeting with us and challenging us through your word. And Lord, tonight I pray that you would set aside our concerns and our cares, and set aside busy thoughts, and Lord, pray that you would also cleanse us of sin, anything that would hinder your Holy Spirit. And Lord, I pray you'd cause us to focus upon your word, and may you speak to our hearts as your people by your Holy Spirit through the word that is preached tonight. Help us as your people to have, Father, a right focus. And Lord, help us in this area that we're going to look at tonight, Father, to, Lord, be where you want us to be and not where we want to be. And Lord, may tonight, if someone's not saved, may they see their need for a Savior, true riches, not false. And Lord, may their soul find a resting place in the finished work of Calvary. And for we, your people, help us, Lord, tonight, not to be hearers only, but doers of thy word. We ask and pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. We've been looking at authentic Christianity according to the book of James. And last night we considered an area the Lord wanted us to grow up in, and the very first area, and it really in many ways is always the first area. He wanted us to grow up in our attitude toward trials and tribulations. Notice in chapter 1, in verse number 2, he says, "My brethren," this is what we looked at last night, "My brethren, count it all joy when ye fall into divers temptations. The word temptations there is tests or trials, troubles, if you will, tribulations. Notice why in verse 3, we saw it last night, knowing this, that the trying of your faith worketh patience, but let patience have her perfect work, that ye may be perfect and entire, wanting nothing. Christian, if you and I want to be what God wants us to be, the very first area we've got to grow up in is in our attitude toward trials and tribulations. And the number one thing last night we looked at that you and I need to bring when a trial or a test or a tribulation comes into our life was patience. Patience is the response God wants from us. You know, if you were to go see the doctor and he were to analyze you, and I remember Brother Prish sharing this, it's kind of unique, but, you know, responding and reacting are two different things. You know, a reaction is negative. He gives you the inoculation, he gives you your medicine, and then he has you come in 24 hours later and he goes, you are reacting to what I gave you. What he's saying is, you're breaking out, right? You're having a reaction. Let me tell you, when trials come in our life, God doesn't want us to react. He wants us to respond. And that's what the doctor would say. You're responding well to the medication. You know, it's sad, but most Christians, when something doesn't go their way, most of us, when something comes along that's unexpected, that, you know, we would deem not to be good, you know, we react. We don't respond. Let me tell you what happens. When we react and don't respond, we lose the opportunity for two things. Number one, we lose the opportunity to bring glory to God in this dark world. Amen? You remember the Bible made it very clear in Philippians 2. You don't need to turn there. But when you and I give patience and respond with patience in the midst of the trial, we become lights in this darkened world. Because you know what? Most lost people aren't patient in tribulation. Amen? Most lost people get carnal. They drop kick the cat. They punch a hole in the wall. They use filthy language. They get all upset. That's how the lost, unregenerate people respond. Now, you and I, sinners saved by grace, we have the capacity to do that, don't we? Sir. Don't go too quiet or have your spouse tell on you, all right? We do have the ability to sin. But you need to recognize if you're saved, you have the ability to also exercise patience. God gives you that grace. And when you and I exercise patience, first of all, we bring glory to God. But second of all, we grow in our faith. Before you can be godly, you have to be patient, according to Peter. Amen? And so, the first thing we saw is God wants us to grow up in our attitude toward trials and tribulations. Let patience have her perfect work. But then second of all tonight, in chapter 2, he moves to another thought, and I want to go there. He wants you and I as Christians, as his children in this world, to grow up in our attitude towards what we treasure and value. I'm going to say that again. He wants you tonight, and he wants me tonight, to grow up in our attitude toward what we treasure and what we value. And notice in this instance, it's seen in our treatment of people. Now, there's three things in our text that we read. Number one, I want to look at the first thing. We're going to consider the testimony of Christ. We're going to consider the testimony of our Savior. What was his reputation? If you could say it that way. I mean, what was he known for? The testimony of Christ. Second of all, I want to consider the testing of the Christian. And remember, last night I said our faith always gets tested. You never know the value of your faith until it's tested. And the life is where faith gets tested. We're going to see the testing of the Christian. And then thirdly, the tragedy. The tragedy of the congregation. Look with me, the testimony of Christ. Look in verse number 1. What was his testimony? The Bible says in James chapter 2 and verse 1, he says, my brethren, have not the faith of our Lord Jesus Christ. Notice this, the Lord of glory. Who was and is Jesus Christ? Well, James tells us he's the Lord of glory. What does that mean? His power and his preeminence is noted here. He is an amazing Savior. Isaiah was asked, if you will, almost, it was, but he said, this Jesus Christ, who is he? He's wonderful. He's Counselor. He's the mighty God. He's the everlasting Father. He's the Prince of Peace. You close out in Revelation chapter 1, and Jesus Christ is shown clearly to be the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the one which is and which was and which is to come, the Almighty God. A few years ago when I was here preaching on Revelation, I remember reminding you that Jesus Christ isn't a slice of God. He's not one third of God. He's not this little piece of God that comes back like a lamb. No, He is the Almighty God, the eternal I Am. He is the King and the Lord of glory. All right, that's who He is. But in this life, when He came to this earth, this Lord of glory was an individual of poverty. He was an individual of poverty. The Bible tells us that, 2 Corinthians 8, 9, it says that though He was rich, yet for your sakes He became what? He became what? Say it.
Poor.
Why? That ye through His poverty might be made rich. Though He's the King of glory, though He's the eternal I Am, though He's the everlasting Father and the great I Am, in this life He was an individual of poverty. He was a man in an individual poverty in His birth. He showed up in a manger. He couldn't even get the Motel 6 wouldn't even let Him in. Nobody even put Him in the cheapest motel you could find. He was born and birthed in a manger. His entrance into this world was an obscurity and poverty. Bethlehem, not Jerusalem. Bethlehem, obscure little Bethlehem in a manger. He entered this world in poverty. He was an individual poverty not only in His birth, but in His life. The Bible makes it very clear, Matthew 8, 20. He said, foxes have holes, birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man hath not where to lay His head. In this life He was a man and an individual of poverty. In His death He was an individual of poverty. He was buried in a borrowed tomb. He was crucified as a criminal. In fact, Isaiah, looking ahead from the prophecy in Isaiah 53, said there's no form, there's no comeliness that we should even desire Him. He's despised, rejected of men. And he made his grave with the poor. He made His grave with individuals that were obscure. You know, if anybody would have judged the value of our Savior during His earthly ministry based simply on appearance, they would have gotten it wrong. Y'all with me? If they would have just evaluated His value, the King of glory, owned the cattle on 1,000 hills, everything was created by Him and for Him and consists because of, if they were to evaluate the eternal I Am in His earthly ministry based simply on what they saw, they would have gotten it wrong. Amen? And the Lord says this. Go back to our text. He says in verse 1, my brethren, have not the faith of our Lord Jesus. It's not even your faith. It's His faith. The faith of our Lord Jesus, the Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord of glory. Notice this. With respect of persons. The Lord says, don't mix my faith with favoritism. You know, during His ministry, He was known as one who did not regard the person of men. Was not that true? The Pharisees said that. We know you don't regard the person of men. That means you don't elevate others over somebody else. But you're simply a friend of sinners. Amen? The testimony of Christ was simply this. Though He was the Lord of glory in this life, He was a man of poverty. And notice with me, you and I need to get this right. You and I need to reflect the Lord in His value system. We don't need to base our evaluation simply on what our eyes see. We do not want to base our value system on what's simply physical. We have to note the spiritual. Amen? We can't just look at the material. We can't just look at the temporal. We cannot base how we live and what we do simply on this life and what we see and what we can touch and what we can feel. Because if that's all we base it on, we would get it wrong too. You with me?
Yes, sir.
But let me tell you something about this world. They want to base everything just on this kingdom down here. That's what they want to base it on. This is how they operate. This is the place of their joy. This is their heaven. This is it for them. But it shouldn't be for us. We should value what he values. You and I should exalt what he exalts. And we should be, of all people on the face of this earth, we should promote what he promotes. Notice the testing of the Christian. And every church gets this, and every Christian gets this, if not monthly, weekly, and sometimes daily, or even hourly. But notice the test comes. Notice the word for in verse number 2. He's referencing back to being respecters of persons. And look at what he says. For if there come unto your assembly a man with a gold ring and goodly apparel, there come in also a poor man in vile raiment. And ye have respect to him that weareth the gay clothing, and say unto him, sit thou here in a good place, and say to the poor, stand thou there, or sit here under my footstool. Are ye not then partial in yourselves, and are become judges of evil thoughts? Notice here, we see the testing of the congregation. Two men enter the congregation. One of them is very powerful and very wealthy. Everything he wears speaks of preeminence. It speaks of a high position of power. It speaks of authority. The ring always spoke of authority. He's probably got a nice three-piece suit from Christopher and Banks. You know what I'm saying? I mean, when he walks in, just everything about what you see, how he carries himself, how he's attired, everything, just says this is somebody who's somebody. Right, a man like that walks into the congregation on a Sunday morning. They're a visitor, first-time visitor. We've never seen him before, but right behind him comes another guy. He looks like the homeless person. He's in tattered clothes, you know. He maybe we could say he's in his blue jeans and they're frayed. And, you know, he comes on in and he doesn't look like much. Scripture makes it very clear. It says here that there comes in also a poor man in vile raiment. He might even smell, you know. He said, and you go ahead and you show that man who outwardly looks more valuable, you give him a higher place. And the other individual, you stuff somewhere where he'll fit. You know, the church didn't know their backgrounds. The church didn't know their spiritual status. The church didn't know their character, their integrity, or even their spiritual maturity. Yet, they showed favor towards one over the other simply based on outward appearance.
Yes, sir.
That was it. Imagine if this Sunday morning we had two visitors come in. One is a famous sports star. You know, who's the quarterback for New England? What's his name?
Brady.
Now, Tom Brady comes into the congregation, you know. And then right behind him comes a homeless guy. Now, let me tell you something. At the end of the service, I don't have my phone. Okay, this is my phone. All right? It's about right. At the end of the service, who would you want to be photographed with? You know what I'm saying? Who would you want to be texting? Say, guess who I met that day? You know what I'm saying? Everybody says, oh, of course, the homeless guy. Seriously? Now, I'll be quite frank, I don't know Tom Brady's spiritual standing with the Lord. But I don't know the homeless guy's spiritual standing with the Lord either. But based on appearance or notoriety, we're going to elevate one above the other? That's not right. Why do we have men's persons in admiration? I'll tell you why. Because we get something out of that. It's called personal gain. You with me? You ever play that game? Guess who I met? You ever play that game? And you know, it's sick when, and it's so easy to slip into. Somebody says, guess who I met the other day? I say, who? And they'll say, oh, wow. And what do? You take the lure as it goes by and you say, well, guess who I met a couple years ago? Don't you? I mean, guess who I met once? And you tell them. And then it keeps going, but, oh, guess who I met? You know what I'm saying? And pretty soon it becomes a competition to see who has the most important individual that you have ever met in your life. Why do we do that? Because then that makes us more important. You know what I'm saying? And I've often thought, you know, when you get in that game, wouldn't it just be easy to just cut to the chase and say, guess who I met? The King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. He saved me. I'm in His family. His Father, His God of the entire universe is my Heavenly Father. And then, you know, I always feel like saying, beat that one. You know, you just, come on, come on, come on. The best they can do is tie you. All right, some of you are going, what? We'll let you in on that, guys, afterwards. But the best they can do is tie you, is get into the family too. You know what I'm saying? I believe there are times God tests our congregation, Trinity. He'll send somebody in that's obscure. And I'll just say, I met Mindy for the first time this last Sunday. How'd you treat her? Don't know anything about her. I didn't know anything about her. I just said hi. You know, how'd you treat? Did you even say hi? He said, well, I don't know anything. She didn't look that important. Well, it doesn't matter. She's important enough for Jesus to die for. Yes. Amen? I mean, God sends her to us, right? And we sit and don't do... In fact, I've been in churches, if somebody comes in and sits in the seat they're not supposed to, I've seen somebody say, you're in my seat. It's like, oh, you're kidding me. Oh, who are you pointing out? What's going on over here? What are you, ladies? If we charge for seats, I wonder which would be more valuable. People say, well, with preaching like this, I'd think I'd pay more for the back seat. Hopefully it'd be the front seat. I was struck by that moment in Connecticut when we saw the state senator come to the Lord on one side of the aisle, and on the other side, an old veteran, an old biker from Boston. And you know what struck me about that? I know that senator's name, but I don't know the biker's name. You see, it's our nature. I let people know a senator came to the Lord. Well, biker did too. The senator's name was, I don't remember the biker's name. But you understand tonight, their soul is equal in value. You know what I'm saying? God will test us all the time in our value system. The tragedy of the congregation was simply this, and look what happened in verse 4. Are ye not then partial in yourselves and become judges of evil thoughts? The tragedy of the congregation was simply this, they got it wrong. They got it wrong. They became partial in their judgment. They valued one above another. And here's something I've noticed in my life, that when I show favoritism, when I lean a certain direction, I elevate a certain type of individual, what I simply do is I reveal my heart.
Yes, sir.
Story is told of an Indian in the 1800s, late 1800s, taking a tour in New York City on foot. And frankly, I've been to New York City. That's probably the quickest way to get through Manhattan, is just walk it with a backpack. In And it's amazing more people don't get killed. I mean, it's like who's ever been to Manhattan, I'm telling you, it's like between the cabs and the vehicles and the people and the double-decker buses and the bikes. You know, I mean, it's just like this swish watch. And how more people don't get run, you say, well, when do you walk? Don't even worry about the lights. When the crowd walk, you walk, right? Crowd stops, you just stop. Don't go out there. Don't go out there. I don't care what the light says. They know, you know. The story is told of an Indian getting a tour, and he's going through the city on foot, and all of a sudden he turns to the individual, a very wealthy man, and says to him, did you hear that bird? And that man turns to him and says, how can you, in all of this noise, and how could you possibly hear a bird? I didn't hear a bird. How can you hear a bird? And then all of a sudden, you hear some loose change go hitting the pavement and rolling down the street, and the guy goes, oh, did you hear that? You know, when we hear things, when we see things, when we lean a certain way, when we elevate certain things, you know all we do? We just reveal what's on our heart. So that's what the Lord was saying there. The indictment wasn't necessarily the impartiality. The indictment was the showing of what their heart was all about. They showed favoritism to the one guy because that's really what they loved themselves. The tragedy of the congregation is they failed the test. Go to 1 Samuel. Watch this in 1 Samuel chapter 16. Because their heart wasn't in tune with God's heart, they got it wrong. And I want to make it very clear, when your and my heart isn't in tune with God's heart, we will get it wrong every time. In 1 Samuel, look what's said in 1 Samuel chapter 16. God has called Samuel to anoint the next king of Israel. Very familiar passage here. And notice in verse number 6, Samuel shows up and he's ready to anoint the next king of Israel. 1 Samuel chapter 16 and verse 6. And look at it. He says, and it came to pass, 1 Samuel 16:6, when they were come, that he there is Samuel, looked on Eliab, that would be the firstborn in Jesse's household, and said, listen to what he said, surely the Lord's anointed is before him. Well, he looked on that firstborn. Look out for Jesus. He looked on that firstborn and he said, that guy looks like a king. You know what I mean? Oh man, if we want a king, that's the one we want, you know. By the way, that's how Saul got picked. Yep. He was head and shoulders above everybody else. He was the big boy in the room, you know. Notice the response in verse 7. But the Lord said unto Samuel, look not on his countenance or on the height of his stature. Why not? Because I have refused him, the Lord says. And notice what he goes on to explain. For the Lord seeth not as man seeth Samuel. For man looketh on the outward appearance, but the Lord looketh on the heart. You know what I see here? Samuel initially got it wrong. He was ready to anoint what God had rejected. You know, you say, well, so? Hey, let me tell you something. If Samuel can get it wrong, we can get it wrong. You with me? If Samuel can get this thing wrong, the evaluation and proper value system and proper priorities, if Samuel can get that wrong, very spiritual man, you and I can get it wrong also. You say, well, but how did Samuel get it right? He got the word of the Lord to him is what happened. God spoke to him and said, hey, don't do that. Here's how I operate. And he directed him by his word and said, there's who you're going to... There's the one right there. If you remember right, he had to really be listening to the Lord because he ran through every kid that was in the room. You know, the last one, I think I would have said, you know, this has got to be it. And instead, he didn't have peace. God didn't give him peace. And so he asked, do you have anybody else? Wow, that's spiritually minded. You know what I'm saying? But here's the thing. Samuel initially got it wrong. And you and I need to recognize we can get it wrong as well. I put this down. You and I, if we don't get in tune with the Word of God, if you and I, as Pastor preached last night, walk through our life without the presence of God, And let me tell you something. When that happens, you and I can get comfortable without him. We can fake it. We can go through the motions. I know our movement. I know us as people. We know the verbiage. We know what to say. We know how to act. We know how to run a song service. We know how to, you know, say amen. We can go through the motions. Never have the presence of God. We've walked away from him. Or he said, hey, I'm not going where you're going. You still belong to me, but you're on your own now. And when that happens, let me tell you something. If you and I are not in tune with the Word of God, we'll begin to accept what God rejects. We'll begin to anoint what God does not want anointed. We'll begin to put our blessing on what God says, I don't bless. Amen? I've seen it all the time. We'll put our blessing on an attitude God doesn't want. I don't know where it was, but for years our movement lifted up and glorified what I called angry fundamentalism. Just mean and angry people. You know what I'm saying? That would strut and could just like a big corporate CEO make it happen. You know what I'm saying? Let me tell you something. The Bible is very clear. You and I are supposed to speak the truth in love. I'm glad men like Brother Prisk were in my life. You know, in your home and in your life, in the house of God, there's sometimes things that you anoint and you bless and you accept, and God says, I don't accept that attitude. That's a bad attitude, you know? I don't accept that association you've got. I know you're trying to spin it and say it's okay, but it's not okay with me. And if you and I aren't careful, we'll put the blessing on what God doesn't want to bless. There's three things that God elevates. Look in verse 5. Go back to our text. As we consider this, you and I need to grow up in our attitude toward what we treasure and value. And oftentimes it's revealed by who and how we treat people. Who it is we treat and how we treat them. Look at what God elevates in James chapter 2 and verse 5. There's three things in a single verse that God lifts up. This is what God blesses. This is what God anoints. Verse 5, he says, hearken, my beloved brethren, hath not God chosen the poor of this world, look at this, here it comes, rich in faith. Number one. Number two, and heirs of the kingdom which he hath promised to them that love him. I see three things that God blesses there. Number one, God elevates those who are rich in faith. You know what the world elevates? The world just elevates those who are rich. Isn't that true? That's the ooh and ah. But God doesn't elevate those who are rich. In fact, he says, as you read that a little further, he said, most of the time, those are the ones that are the opposite of what I value. They're the ones that persecute you. God elevates those, number one, who are in faith. The world just elevates those who are rich. Number two, God elevates those who are heirs of the kingdom. That would be the saved, amen? You say, well, how far does he elevate them? All the way into heaven, amen? He lifts us all the way to heaven. He gives us his kingdom. We're heirs of the kingdom. He elevates that because it cost his son for that. And then thirdly, he elevates those who love him. Do you see that in verse 5? Those who love him, not those who love the world. I wonder tonight what you elevate. What do you admire? You say, well, how do I ever figure that out? There's some ways to figure that out. First of all, who you talk about is who you admire and who you elevate. Y'all with me? Okay, just nod, because that is, it's true. Who you talk about is who you admire. All right? Hopefully, spouses, you talk about each other in a good way. Remember when you were courting? That's all you could talk about. Guys, was her. You admired her. You elevated her. Wow. You know, she was the one you talked about. And vice versa. First of all, who you talk about. Second of all, who you spend your money on. Where you spend it will tell you what you admire. I did something tonight. I was studying this out and I thought, you know, I wonder where my affections are. Because the Lord makes it very clear, set your affections not on things down here, but set your affection on things above. I wonder how I did. And what I do is I have a number of ways that it's things I shortcut my taxes, but I'm one of those weird guys. I like a credit card that I pay an annual fee on that gives me a nice year-end summary. This is my secretary right here. Because Amex goes ahead, I have to pay it off every month, but American Express goes ahead and itemizes it. Listen to the itemization. I'm not going to give you the dollar amounts, right? I'm just going to give you... All right, I run almost everything through my Amex until I meet the merchant that says, we don't do Amex, which is a fee issue because American Express is horrible on the merchants for fee. So then I have a Visa as a backup. But it also has a year-end summary. But Amex is 90% of what I do is through this thing. I have the following. Here's how my life breaks down according to American Express and my dollars I spend. Okay? I have business services. I have communications, that be the cell phone. I have entertainment. There's an entertainment category, and there's some dollars there. You say, what's your entertainment? Just God's people. They're fun to watch. I go to dinner a lot of times with people, and they say, what happened? I said, well, we had a dinner, and then I got to meet the couple that was hosting it, and boy, they're a pair. We call that a dinner theater. Very entertaining, you know. So I have entertainment. I have fees and adjustments. I have no clue. Oh, that's the Amex fee. Merchandise and supplies. I have restaurant. I have transportation. I have travel. You with me? This thing breaks it down. And I told Deb tonight, I said, wow. Now I know what we give, hon, because I'm writing the checks all the time. And we are involved in the tithe. We're involved in the offering. We're involved in faith promise missions and in even more stuff than that. But just the majority of it is right through here. And I said, I know what we give. And I told her, I said, I wonder what I treasure and value more. The kingdom that's up there, or the kingdom that's down here. Now, it's not fair, and I told her, I said, it's not fair to say lodging. We got to have a place, right? But I'm talking about entertainment, vacations, when we eat out, right? And so I looked through that. And praise the Lord, we invest way more in the kingdom than we do those things down here. That's all I'm going to say. Now, this is gritty preaching, but let me tell you something. You give me your checkbook ledger. You give me your breakdown at the end of the year. You let me see where your money goes, and I will tell you what your value system is. I will tell you what you admire. Isn't it sad today in our young people? They admire the sports stars more than the missionary that's been out there for 40 years serving God. I'm not saying you guys do, but I'm just saying that's something you got to consider. Because you look at LeBron James when they won the ring and all that. That guy has spiritual issues. That's all I'm going to say. That guy is not a spiritually minded guy. The symbology and stuff. But I know a lot of times Christian young people, they would rather be known to have met him than some missionary that came in off the field serving faithfully for 40 or 50 years. I mean, you'll see the sports posters in there, but you won't see the missionary posters in there. I'm just trying to... You with me?
Yes, sir.
You and I, as God's people, got to get this right. It's one thing for the world to get it wrong. That's to be expected. But here in James chapter 2, you know what was sad? You know what the tragedy of the congregation was? The congregation got it wrong, and they shouldn't have gotten it wrong. They should have had the right value system. They should have valued what he values, and they should have elevated what he elevated. They shouldn't have gone the other way around. Amen? The world system had blinded them. And in verse number 9 of James chapter 2, notice the result of that respecting of persons, they were committing sin and were transgressors. As I close tonight, you know, we look at Faith Promise Missions. You know the focus of Faith Promise Missions? It's not this kingdom down here. It's that kingdom that's coming. That is the focus. And I understand there's joy that comes when you give, and that's the temporary thing that I receive when I give. I've always said that when you look at missions and you look at investing in the kingdom and investing in lost people, it's a blessing to be a part of that because that doesn't disappear. That fruit remains forever. You know what I'm saying? You can buy a car and that thing can wreck and it can be gone. But let me tell you, when you're a part of seeing somebody make peace with God, get saved, sins forgiven, that's eternal fruit. And there's a blessing in knowing I had a part in that. You know what I'm saying? I had a part in that. And our attitude shouldn't be, you know, do I have to? Do I have to? You know, the attitude should be, do I get to? This world pours its money down rat holes every day. And the best they'll get is temporary pleasure, but never eternal gain. And you know why? Because it's the only value system they know. But when we get saved, we meet a second value system. We see true riches. Right? We don't see the temporary, we see the eternal. We don't just see the visible, we see the invisible through the Word of God and the Spirit of God. You know what I'm saying? We don't just see the physical, we see the spiritual. And at that moment, literally, and we all had to do this, I remember, we make this decision. Now, which one is going to be my primary investment? And the Lord wants us to get this right. He wants us to get this right. And there's no reason we shouldn't, because we have His Word and we have His Spirit. We have no excuse if we don't get this right. In America today, all across our land, as I close, we are a nation, America is a nation that admires rebellion and mocks righteousness. We are a nation that promotes money over morals all the time. We despise the poor even if they're rich in faith, and we admire the rich even though they oppress the poor. We elevate the lost. And in essence, what we do, we end up mixing the faith of the Lord with respect to persons. As I close tonight, I simply say this. Love what He loves. Amen? Determine you're going to love what He loves. You say, what does He love? I can tell you, He loves sinners. He loves lost people. He loves the souls of men and women, boys and girls. He loves the written word. He, the living word, loves the written word. You know, he loves His kingdom. Not this kingdom, His kingdom. Lift up what He lifts up. And value what He values. Grow up in your attitude, He says, towards what you treasure and value. I say it this way. Get the price right. Remember old Bob Barker and The Price is Right? I grew up. I mean, remember that, Doug? We'd watch that. It wouldn't be at Dad's house. It was only at Grandma Berquist's house. Daytime TV was out on the farm. All five black and white channels weren't allowed on in the daytime. My dad's ranch. But we get to Grandma B's, man. We got to watch stuff, you know. But Bob Barker and The Price is Right. What was the whole goal of the show? The show was to get the price right. Be as close to that value without going over it. You know what I'm saying? He'd say, come on down. You're the next contestant on The Price is Right. And the goal is to get it right. And let me say this. Every day of our life, every week, Christian, we're living in a world that has a whole different value system. It elevates things that God doesn't want to elevate. It puts down things God wants elevated. And you and I have to make a determine what value we're going to put on everything we meet and who we meet and where our time goes. And we got to get this right. We've got to get the price right. Our value system has got to line up with His. Amen? And so tonight, as we close, I say this, let's grow up. Let's go up. Let's be praying about what we can give. If you don't have a faith promise card, get one. If you're a member of the church, be a part of this. And Trinity, I'm going to say this. I'm going to commend you. I looked at the bulletin on the back, the giving for missions, and I said, wow. I said, wow. But you know what? That's good, but I don't know how big the wow should be. You know what I mean? Because I don't know the resources, only God does. But I do want to say this. I'm not berating, I'm commending you, but let's pray about even lifting His kingdom more. Amen? Let's value what He values. Let's be a part of this. Let's stand. Father, we thank You, Lord, tonight for this thought. And Lord, I pray tonight as we consider our faith that it would grow. Help us this year as Your children. I pray for every individual that's a member of the work here. Lord, help our faith to grow this year. Help us not to just simply stay where we were, but Lord, help us to even invest further in the kingdom's cause. And Lord, forgive us for oftentimes lifting up what You don't want lifted up. Father, endorsing what You don't want endorsed. Blessing what You don't want blessed. And anointing and putting our blessing on that which You don't want to anoint. Lord, help our value system to be Yours. Help us to delight in those who are rich in faith. Hebrews chapter 11. Those kind of people. Help us, Lord, to delight in those who are saved. And Father, help us to love those who love You. Help our value system to be in line with Yours, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed for just a moment. Music's going to play softly. You slip.